Hi, I'm Yehuda Kurtzer of Shalom Hartman Institute North America, and I'm grateful to the folks at M Squared and the Schusterman Fellowship and Aim Prad for giving me an opportunity to be part of the Days of Gratitude project and to talk to you a little bit today. You know, one of the more strange and provocative aspects of Jewish peoplehood is that the Jewish people are made up of a subset of different tribes. In other words, we're not just one people, we're actually a people with a number of different groupings within that people. And this is strange partly because, you know, one of the characteristics of Jewish history is us as being marked off from others. And it's interesting that we bake into our own identity that we're not just marked off by others, but that there are subgroups within our population, within our people. But it's provocative also because the word tribes is connected to a very dangerous ism, that of tribalism. And there's a instinct or a suggestion that there's problematics that come with what it means to have all of these different subgroups inside our own people. But there it is right from the get-go. Our people go from Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and not just in the book of Exodus to become the Jewish people. We become the children of Israel. And the Jewish people is made up of all of these tribes. And that story carries through surprisingly far into the story. You might think that after the sons of Israel have become the Jewish people, that that category would replace the tribe story. But throughout the Bible, the land gets inherited among the different tribes. And the narrative of the tribes as an enduring feature of what the Jewish people are about stays there throughout. Well, after the destruction of the temple, the Jewish people perhaps let go of the story of particular tribes. None of us really walk around anymore saying, I'm the tribe of Benjamin and you're the tribe of Reuben. But we do hold on to the notion that there are subgroups within our people, that there are schools of thought, communities of difference, ideologies, denominations, etc. One of my favorite pieces by my teacher, Shaya Cohen at Harvard, is identifying that the Mishnah, the first rabbinic document in the third century, is pioneering in its time for preserving the legitimacy of multiple ideas, multiple schools, and multiple viewpoints in debate and dialogue with one another without resolving the core legitimacy of one school of thought over another. In other words, as the Jewish people in the Bible are represented as one people made up of sub-tribes, Rabbinic Judaism is one people made up of different schools of thought. And that carries through, of course, to our own times with the continued existence and flourishing of denominations who have major ideological and political disputes with one another, sometimes extraordinarily hostile. Sometimes those denominations even tend to believe that they are not just the true believers in what Judaism is about, but that others are illegitimate tribes. And I suppose that that is simply just a consequence of what it means to have a people that preserves dissent and difference. And not just we're part of the same group, but we disagree, but we actually see ourselves as sub-tribes, sub-communities, sub-cohorts of what it means to be a Jew. And we know all the dangers that come with all of these differences. Tribes and tribalism gets a bad rap. Denominational differences invite us to be in competition and sometimes combatively with one another. And we know all of the jokes that the Jewish people have about, you know, two Jews and three shuls. It all gets quite a bad rap. The worst risk that comes with the belief that we are made up of sub-tribes is not just that we're going to disagree with one another. That's okay. The worst trap is that we become morally narcissistic, that our communities, our cohorts, our congregations, even our identities, right, when we become so passionately loyal to those of us who resemble ourselves, that narrows our field of vision and reduces the possibility to have an empathetic relationship to those who are not like us. And that happens all the time, where you become so passionate about your micro commitments that you lose a field of vision of what they're supposed to be about. But I think this is the radical idea of the tribes story in the Bible. The Jewish people are not marked as other from other nations in order to think of ourselves as being morally narcissistic. The reason we mark ourselves off as other, and the reason we preserve boundaries around our own group identity, is because we argue that it is through the preservation of the particular that we can care passionately about the universal. We all know this to be true in any community that we're in. It's because we live in small communities, cohorts of friends, congregations that we go to, tribes to which we belong, denominations to which we attach, that we not only can feel taken care of and held by others who are like us. It's not just that we can celebrate community, that we can mourn our losses, that we can be visited when we're sick or visit others. It's not just that we benefit deeply, emotionally and spiritually from those relationships, but ideally, those types of relationships enable us to see beyond them. Or put differently, it's precisely because I can see the human challenges and struggles of those who I'm in close community with that I can extrapolate and see something much larger. After all, it's very difficult for us as individual human beings to feel responsible for all the human beings in the world. But it might be possible that because of our communities, our congregations, our cohorts, our tribes, our identities, our particular loyalties, that we might be able to take greater responsibility for the human story that's all around us. In a moment like this, in this coronavirus pandemic, for many of us, our circles have grown narrower. We are not just members of congregations or communities or tribes or identities. We've constrained even further. We might now, our teams might be those who we work with because we see them on Zoom a lot, or might just be the members of our family. But I see also the ways in my life, and for which I feel grateful, to live in micro communities. The members of my congregation who check up on me once in a while, the members of my local community who I can see from my porch and who I can check in with as well, those who experience this pandemic with the same theological or philosophical frames of reference that I do, because that gives me joy and comfort to know that there are worlds of interpretation that might help me and those who are close to me to weather this. And through that, I have found a tremendous ability to feel a close relationship to this world in which all of us are experiencing a story of illness and of suffering that does not actually discriminate on the basis of tribes, communities, cohorts, or those types of difference. In other words, the portal of the particular, our communities, our cohorts, yes, and even our tribes, gives us access to and vehicles through which to understand that which is afflicting all of us. And so I'm grateful for them. I think this is a moment for us to look around and say, who are my people? Not because those people are better than others, not because the people who are not my people I shouldn't care about, but who are my people, both because of the ways that they provide us comfort and meaning, but because they are the vehicle through which we can take responsibility for so much more.